Thank you very much.
Let me also get closer. Let me also get closer.
Thank you very much, Chair, and good morning to honourable members of the committee. Good morning, Deputy Minister. Good morning to our colleagues who are here. Chair, let me appreciate the opportunity you have given me and the committee to come and engage with you this morning. As you have correctly indicated, Chairperson, maybe let me check, Chair, if a report was circulated to honourable members. Thank you. As you have correctly indicated, Honourable Chair, it's a topical matter which has been on our media reports and has gained attention in discussion over the matter. Dealing with the tenor in which I was the executive mayor of Polokwane municipality and questioning whether I acted improper or it could have been a best decision made differently. I want to thank the committee for the opportunity once more. I'm not going to go through the report verbatim as members have it, but I've prepared opening remarks which just really touches into the report. And I'm sure when we get the opportunity to deliberate on the report, then we will, I will be responding to the matters that honorable members would want to make. Honourable members, it's a matter of public record again that Polokwane municipality invested money in VBS in my tenure as an executive mayor. But what is not amplified is that on the advice from technical expertise within the municipality, myself as a mayor instituted the withdrawal of Polokwane investment from VBS. My attitude at the time was that if there was anything improper with regards to municipality funds, it must be stopped forthwith. It is important to note that the withdrawal took place 2 months even before the letter from National Treasury ordered all municipalities who were investing in VBS to withdraw their investment. The published allegations are anchored around two questions in the main. Did I have an improper relationship with the contractor appointed by the municipality which I served as a mayor? And secondly, did I receive financial benefits from the same contractor? Honourable Chair, allow me to deal with this question. And the first one, the improper relationship. I did not have any improper relationship with the contractor appointed by the municipality. And let me give the context to this assertion. I will touch a bit on the appointment process of Gundu as the financial advisor on investment decisions of the municipality. Mayors are never involved, or councillors are never involved in procurement. So the work of appointment of a service provider is the responsibility of executives in the municipality. And in this instance, an advert was run, a supply chain management process was undertaken, and Gundu Wealth Solutions was appointed as the investment manager, financial advisor to the municipality for a period of 3 years. This advisory work was undertaken at no financial cost to the municipality, meaning it was not a tender where you are building a house and then there is a particular budget and you are. So it was an unsolicited bid where you work at the commission that you are receiving, it's what you get to be paid for. So there is no money that was paid by Polokwane municipality to Gundu. Honourable members, I will also want us to investigate whether I had relations of any kind with Gundu Wealth. We must start with the appreciation that as I indicated, they are not a contractor and they did not receive payment. They were appointed to provide services through a procurement process, and this was done through committees of council, which are overseeing procurement, and as per Section 52 of the MFMA, which mandates the municipal manager to report the financials of the municipality every quarter, a report was brought to council to note the appointment of Gundu Wealth Solutions. Did I receive any improper benefits? I did not receive any improper benefits from the contractor, as indicated. Again, I would want to give a bit of some context. When one is appointed as an office bearer in public service, maybe I must start that before being a public office bearer, I've worked for Limpopo Provincial Government for about 15 years, from a position of an assistant director, right all the way when I resigned, I was an acting DDG. Having moved from Safety, Security, Agriculture, Office of the Premier, in fact, Office of the Premier, then Agriculture, Department of Public Works, moved into being an office bearer in the public service. It becomes difficult to obtain employment outside public service and even to assist family members due to nepotism and favoritism or any other explanation. But also, political positions by their very own nature are short term. And that necessitated me that I investigate a feasibility of commencing such a business, and a coffee shop seemed a feasible option so that I could create employment opportunities for myself and my next of kin. The coffee shop employed between 8 to 12 people, depending on some of the work that was contractual, and the staff may not be permanent on a day-to-day basis. And I made this consideration precisely because to ensure that I have got an alternative when the office, public office life comes to an end. Initially, I intended to withdraw partially from my retirement savings, which were coming from the pension of being an employee of the state for about 15 years. I experienced difficulties because of the cost and the charges. If I recall very well, the pension was somewhere at around 800,000 odd, and the percentage of tax and all that was making the whole idea not feasible. Best I could finance, and I was advised against the withdrawal of the retirement savings that I spoke about. And in those discussions, Gundu then informed me and advised of a loan product that they have that I could access. In consideration for the options loan, Gundu was not a service provider, as I said. There existed no conflict in my view in securing a loan from Gundu. I took a decision to proceed with the business, and the following steps ensued. In September 2016, on the 26th, I concluded the registration of T5, which was coming from a previous company that I had incorporated, which was called Golden Threads. On the 30th, I signed with both Gundu and Recovet. Recovet was the owner of the coffee shop where I was purchasing from. Following that loan agreement, 575,600 was paid to Recovet by Gundu Wealth Solutions. The capital advance was repaid as provided for in the loan agreement by 3 installments. And the installments were paid from the FNB business account of T5 and Silvana's events to Gunduweld Netbank account on the following dates. The 9th of October 2020, the 12th of November 2020, and the 7th of January 2021. Chair, I would like to contextualize the reasoning and the timing for the payment. T5 and Golden Threads carried for about 3 years the establishment of the coffee shop. In 2019, in October, was the exact time that Silvana was able to have its account, now trying to be running above board in terms of not being dependent on T5 and Golden Threads. And that was 2019. Preparations were made between myself and Gundu to commence with the payment after the coffee shop had been fully registered in 2019. Prior that, the business T5 to assist the operation of the coffee shop, it was servicing recovered on the other portion that couldn't be paid from the 575, including rental, including equipment, which some recovered left and it had to be paid. In March 2020, in fact, in February or somewhere there, we started getting calls from the Office of the National Treasury and Provincial Treasury, meeting the 12 municipalities and informing us that the bank will be going under administration and they would want to commence with the forensics. I informed Mr. Ralliom because I was now supposed to start with the repayment that I will hold the repayment until the Limpopo provincial investigations are concluded. In total, it was 12 municipalities. If you go to their report, I think Pulukwane is chapter 13 of the report. The investigation took about 18 to 20 months. I may not be exact in terms of calculations. But on the 9th, the very same day I made the payment, was the day I officially received the report in hand as the mayor from Limpopo Provincial Treasury. Because the investigation were concluded and I had fully participated, those who have got experience of understanding that you will then be called, you will have to provide documents, you'll have to provide municipal council resolutions, etc. That process was undertaken and all of us participated from the investment management committee to the executive mayor. I made the first payment on that day, on the 9th of October 2020. And again on the 12th of November, and the final one, totaling around 849,000, with an interest calculated at about 11.2 or so percent at the time. So in excess of about 250 was the interest that was paid to Gundu. I've touched a bit on the Limpopo Treasury investigations. It is important that I indicate to the House that the investigations will obviously come with remedial action and corrective measures. Paragraph 18.92 of that report didn't spare me as the executive mayor from a corrective measure. And I'm quoting it. It is recommended that corrective action be considered against the executive mayor, T. Nkadimeng, in that she failed to comply with Section 52 of the Municipal Finance Management Act. Considering that Polokwane Municipality did not incur any losses, and I, as a mayor, was proactive enough to order the withdrawal of investment, as I indicated, even before National Treasury wrote to us, and the money of council was paid back with its interest into the municipal account. Upon response, we were then taken back again into the Standard Bank, which is the municipal account, by the forensic to go and prove together with the bank as to whether the money was paid truly into the bank, and that step was undertaken. And the corrective measure was sanctioned to us to go either to University of Pretoria or the University of Witwatersrand, which are the only ones that offers, jointly with LG CETA, that is local government CETA, a program which is designed by National Treasury called Municipal Finance Management Act. In short, we call it MFMP. It's a two-year program. I took this corrective measure very seriously. I commenced with my studies the following year when universities opened in January. I registered. It was a block program. I will leave Polokwane every week to come and attend a block of the entire Municipal Finance Management Act in its entirety. I actually concluded, honorable members, this program after I was even no longer a mayor when I was a deputy minister. So ordinarily, if I had not taken that corrective measure seriously, I would have said, well, I'm no longer the mayor, I'm no longer on MFMA, but I will leave it. But I stuck to that 2 years. I concluded the program. I'd like to draw to a close and affirm that, one, there was no improper relationship. I requested for a loan. A loan was advanced. Interestingly, today I saw something circulating which I'd never heard, which indicates even from the other side that the transaction was Silvana's loan. Much has been said about the conflict of interest to the position I now hold. The Department of Justice and Constitutional Development plays no role in decision making by the NPA on who to prosecute or not. The office I hold does not have a direct relationship in instructing or convincing an NPA on how to act on their mandate. On the matter of taking the loan, I've dealt with the allegations of conflict. And my understanding was that if you ask for assistance on someone who doesn't have a direct bearing or payment from the municipality, it is possible, and I repaid it back. When the president informed me that he is assigning me to this department, the issue of conflict of interest actually that crossed my mind was not this issue. It was an issue that I am, on behalf of my family, sitting in court on the case of my sister, that the NPA has placed charges on allegations of murder to PEP. That's what crossed my mind. I discussed it with the president as well, and we both came to a conclusion that it is a matter that is already sitting in court. I have got no say in it. It will live its life, and it will come to its conclusion. And I decided I will take the request by the president, because I also do believe that's what even the person that I thought I shouldn't take the responsibility because of her would have wanted me to put the people of South Africa first. And it was on those bases that I accepted the request by the president. And having convinced myself that even in that case, I cannot, will not, will never be able to influence the NPA on how to do its work. And I wouldn't want to elaborate on the commitment I gave them in my first meeting on my willingness to assist and my willingness to be able to cooperate all the time on any needs that they have and work that they would want to do. Honorable Chair, thank you very much. The report, as I had said, give a bit of more detail than the summarized version that I had. And I would like to thank honorable members once more for the opportunity to come and talk to you. Thank you.